translated a book recently. And we have Vinutha Mallya, who has been in publishing for many years now. She's also an advisor to the publishing next conference. Vinutha will moderate the panel. Thank you.
Beginning with Anurag, Anurag Basnet is the managing editor of Speaking Tiger, and he's been in the publishing industry for 12 years. He began his career with Penguin and has worked at Rupa before he took on this role at Speaking Tiger. He's also a translator himself. He's translated Anil Yadav's Wo Bhi Koi Desh Hai, Maharaj, which is a travelogue in the Northeast, right? And also co-translated Ravish Kumar's book, Free Voice. Maitreyi is a poet and translator. She's now based in Goa. And she recently, her translation of her Sahitya Academy Award winning Kannada novel, Halla Bantu Halla, was published as A Handful of Sesame this year. And she's also working on a translation of musical plays by H.S. Shivaprakash, which is forthcoming. Her writings have appeared, her poetry, translation, theatre reviews have appeared in various publications like the Hindu, Wire, Indian Express, etc. And Vasudhendra is a writer who writes in the Kannada language. He has worked in the software industry for over 20 years before he launched his own publishing house, Chandana Pustaka, which publishes new writing in Kannada. He also has an he also recognizes young short story writers through an award that Chandana Pustaka gives, right? He's the author of 15 books, and which have sold over a lakh copies, and he has won, among other awards, the Sahitya Academy Award as well. And his book, Namamma Andre Nangishta, which is I Like My Mother, has been reprinted 20 times. And of course, Mohana Swami, which is known for, because it came into translation into English and did so well, that is a book that many people know was very well. Shruti. Shruti is a literary agent. Shruti Debi is a literary agent based in Delhi. Her agency, the Debi agency, represents writers of literary fiction and quality nonfiction. Her emphasis is on representing authors who are transitioning between languages and media. And among her clients are Vivek Shanbhag and Srinath Devu, whose internationally acclaimed Rajar Gochar has done so well in the US recently, which is the takeoff point for our discussion. So today is to talk about this new kind of interest that we see that has happened in the cases of Rajar Gochar and One Part Woman, which is slightly different in nature than the translations that have come before, when translations have traveled into the UK or in the US much less so, but definitely books from India have gone to the UK through, you know, various channels in the past. But the interesting thing now is that Americans are taking an interest, and in a sense, in the Anglophile world, they're like the last bastion. They'll never translate. They prefer to read American authors. So this is something interesting. Like, what is this interest about? And to start that, I wanted to ask Anurag, as a publisher whose titles are being represented to publishers outside, do you feel that there is something happening here that is organically bringing about this interest, or is this really a result of a better system of representation at work? That there are more avenues for publishers to meet or for authors to come into contact with publishers elsewhere?
I think it's a combination of both. There is a lot more representation now, absolutely. But personally, I feel like it's not just about representation, it's about what the book themselves, what the books are talking about in terms of larger overarching themes, what is of interest to people elsewhere? Because, you know, there are readers everywhere, right? And everyone has a specific interest in coming to a book. So what is the message, or what is the, you know, what is the message that goes out before the book, right? So I mean, in terms of, let's say, one of our goals,
right.
I think it connects in a sense to this larger idea now about censorship, about ideas of free speech, about ideas of which everyone's engaging with, right? And so like in the US, right? I mean, given the fact that politics, in a sense, has taken a certain turn, that does, you know, it does help in a sense to connect readers to these books, because or books which deal with certain themes, because people are looking for resonances of their own experiences elsewhere. So if something's happening here or anywhere else in the world for that matter, and someone finds resonance, then it helps take that book across, it helps connect the reader to that book. So yeah, representation does help, but it's also a function of much larger forces, much larger ideas. That's what I think.
But how do you then explain how would authors get discovered? Because clearly, I mean, there's a lot of writing that comes out of India, that happens in India and can go. But the ways in which publishers elsewhere discover Indian writing are through what is noticed by them. And how do they notice things? In your opinion, you kind of put up one point, and that's why I want to ask you if there are other forces that besides that. Which is, he speaks about how ideas of censorship or other ideas that help people connect, and that's why certain books become more interesting for publishers who want to publish. But are there, I mean, in the case of Raja Kochar, for instance, what do you think? what really was the interest in Raja Kochar? Because I was surprised, because it is, you know, it is a Kannada story set in, like, at a time, it's about a low-middle class family, there's just so much of Kannada sensibility in it. I was really surprised how it traveled that.
So the thing about Raja Kochar is that it isn't the original text that Vivek wrote, was published as a novella and two short stories. I think that was the combination. And four short stories, yeah. So it was a part of this kind of compendium.
Yeah.
And he felt that it was lost in that collection. But when once it was translated, it was too short, I felt, to even put a spine on. I mean, a book is a physical product, and so Srinath and I had this conversation about, so how was it originally published, and what length was it at in Kannada, and how, etc. Anyway, that long conversation meant that Vivek, who is, now this is a real thing, okay, I don't mean to be morbid or dark, but he's alive. And therefore, he can respond to a translator, he can go back to the work and review it, and maybe revise it. Now, there are things, and I kept saying, I know there's a lot in the Kannada that doesn't need context for the Kannada reader, but I just feel that for the English reader, you can press the story a little more. And there was Vivek wanted to be convinced of this, but actually when he went back to the text, he wrote such beautiful scenes into it that he now says he can't imagine the book was ever without them. Towards the end, there's a sort of sealing scene which really tells you where the narrator was coming from. When he opens his wife's wardrobe and sort of smells her clothes. And that was not there in his original Kannada. And actually that is a very important scene, because before that the narrator, that figure, was in any case quite difficult to pin down. His motivations at least become clear. So well, that was the beginning. Then we found a publisher in India. And you would think that it should be very easy. But the Indian publishing industry, which has just come with a few raps in the previous session, found it very challenging to think of doing a book, you know, but it's so short, and how would we do it, and would we do it in paperback, and would we do it in this format or that format, and so on. It's very bureaucratic. Nevertheless, we found an Indian publisher, and then and in America, I worked with a very good agent called Anna Stein. And Anna Stein, she loved the book, and she set a loop, whatever, 14 publishers, deep submission order, and everybody was just baffled. Till Penguin responded, and it's very particular, you know, you have to know which editor you're sending it to and why they might be interested. And we sent it to the editor at Penguin who had assisted in Kate Boo's Beautiful Forevers or whatever. So she sort of saw beyond the Kachemachar text to see it as a story of the darker sides of the aspiration, material aspiration or liberalization, etc., etc., like the economic shifts that had happened in India. Because of the Kate Boo book, she was already sensitive to this, and then there was this, so she bought it and she was very excited about it, and then there came that conversation which happened, which is that, can we change the title, you know, because it means nothing to anybody in America, to which Srinath wrote back and said, it means nothing to anybody anywhere in the world, it doesn't mean anything in India, and that's why we should hold to it, because it's a nonsense title, and nonsense titles have their own, whatever. And then the New York Times said it's, well, now Vivek is going to be a victim of his own success, because the New York Times has said that the great New Indian novel is only very short. So now anyone has to write 100 pages.
So that's that is the.
And I mean, my next question is to Vasudhendra to take off from that is, your work has been translated into English, but even within the Kannada space, before it could come into translation, there is so much challenge of how to come into translation itself, isn't it? So what have your experiences been when you kind of ventured into that terrain?
The place called Ballari. So Ballari district has got Hampi. Hampi is well known for the Vichar Nakata. So Hampi is the place where Tungabhadra River flows. So whenever someone goes from Ballari district or that area to Varanasi, Kashi, okay, what do they do is, they take one tumbler full of Tungabhadra water, okay, and they pour it in Kashi, that is in Ganga. And while returning back, they take that same tumbler full of Ganga water and they bring it back and they go to Hampi again and they pour it in Tungabhadra. And this is considered as holy act. For me, translation is that. So you have to mix the waters of different rivers. And then that's what is the service which we are supposed to do for the society. From that perspective, translation is very, very important. But what they used to do is, in the olden days, they used to take in a tumbler, that's a brass tumbler, which is called as Rail Chembu in Kannada. It's a very nice artistic this thing, and then they used to pour. Now the times have changed. They take in an airtight plastic bottle, right? And then they pour that one. So for me, that airtight plastic bottle is the English language now. Because English language has become the bridge for the regional commute. Unless it comes in the English, like the regional languages are not showing so much of interest for the book. Very interesting, because Gachar Gochar came in English, so that is the reason why it came in all other languages. It didn't happen. Same thing with my Mohanaswamy. So when Mohanaswamy got translated to English, all people took interest. So English, Telugu, Malayalam, Tamil, Marathi, Hindi, so what all the languages, Spanish, and everywhere it's coming. So that's what it's happening. But people are interested, readers are very much interested in the translation. They would love to read some other story. So interesting is, They read an African story and they say it's same as mine. I have translated translated two books, but more published more than 25 books of translation from various parts of the world, from Africa, from China, from Australia, from French and all. So I always go for autobiography. So I am more particular about autobiographies in Canada. People, Canada readers have to read. When they read that one, an African story, in Kenya, a small tribal boy story, when someone reads it and he comes, a Dalit boy comes and tells me it's my story. You know, it's such an interesting thing, is unknown place where it is, in Africa, in Tanzania and Kenya border, and that boy story resembles a boy, a Dalit boy in Karnataka. That's what is very, very interesting, and we need to do it more and more. A lot of rich literature is there in the regional language. The experiences of the regional language authors are very, very rich. So that needs to be bought in. But what used to happen all this time, I felt, is it's not that it's first time the Gachar Gochar has been translated from Kerala. So there are many novels which have been translated. They are beautiful, fantastic novels. But they didn't succeed. They all didn't succeed. Why? What is the reason? If I look back, the quality of the translation matters a lot. The focus was not given so much for the quality of the translation. Many times, as we know, it was like done as a government work, you know, like just someone has to do. And many translators were not coming forward to do a translation from Kannada to English. So we have really failed. I think there is a lot to learn there. And Gachar Gochar being the first one, I'm so happy. Very interestingly, success of Gachar Gochar in Kannada is not as hyped as that is in English.
That's just telling her that Gachar Gochar is far more successful in America than it is in India. It was reprinted 4 or 5 times in the first 5 months of its publication in America, and we were suddenly at 25,000-30,000 copies in America.
Yeah, that's great. We are all so happy and thrilled that a Kannada book has made such a big wave in the English world.
But they really know how to push it. They are so, so, so committed to the acquisition process. Huh. So when they acquire, they already know how they will sell it. So that there are people who represent Penguin going to some sort of small college in Minnesota in winter, whatever, and finding the one English or South Asian professor who teaches there and saying, you know, there's this wonderful new text and we'll give you an advanced copy. And do you think you could tell your students to pick it up, or could the university bring it or take it or whatever? And this is how. I mean,
it's a snowball effect,
right?
So
they rely on them publishing. And so that's how they make the first
album
in the world, very, very,
very. But the question here is, why didn't happen all these days for the other books?
Srinath is very good.
Yeah, that's where I'm coming from.
Srinath is very good. And I think you have to, I've seen a lot of translation. And I find that a lot of translators are volunteer, and as Jerry said, it's truly almost like volunteering. They volunteer to do it. They are okay in the language that they're translating into, but they're very good in the language that they are translating out of. And this is a problem, because around the world, it's the other way around. You need not be very good at the language that you're looking at the original text is in, but you should be excellent in the language that you're translating into. And Srinath, as a literary person, was very perfect. I mean, was perfect.
So, and there are a lot of...
Vivek is also bilingual, yeah, and he writes exactly as much in English. I mean, he can write in English too, so they've collaborated quite well. But I would like to say that there have been books that have been translated by very good translators too. Some of the collections that that OAP and all have published have been done by, you know, very good quality translators in. But again, measuring success as we do now, Okay, when we look at how books are successful now, it's a lot to do with how much they were, how much they are being written about in the media, how much they are discussed at lit fest, and how much, how visible the authors are. Back in the day, that was not really the yardstick by which this was considered success. Success was very different for a book in translation. Today, a translation is actually looked at the same, in the same way as a source original or a language original text. So they've come, I mean, translations are being treated almost at par, not yet at par, but almost at par, especially in the literary circles, LitFest, and I think LitFest have a lot to do with this too. But moving on to Maitreyi, and because she's just had this experience of looking for a publisher, looking at, and as someone who is, who translates for the love of it, and she does a lot of it, it was tough to find your first publisher, wasn't it?
It was, you know, when I was translating it, it was such joy, you know, it was this amazing, pure joy. And as soon as I finished translating it, then finding a publisher felt quite literally like being evacuated from a happy place. You know, how this happened was, I read this book several years ago and I fell in love with it, and, you know, it seemed to reflect my own. It comes from a part of Karnataka which is not very well represented in literature, and I come from that place. So the language, the nuances, the culture and everything was something that I felt a great connect to, and I felt, and as Shruti was saying, I read Kannada well, but I write English better. So, you know, when I was reading it, I thought, you know, as I kept reading it, every sentence I was wondering how would this sound in English. So I started translating it on my own accord. I took the author's permission, and even he had sort of given up on getting it translated because a couple of people had tried, but they couldn't get the language notes of it and they quit. And also there's another risk that, you know, owing to the quality of our language sounds rough to people who speak the standard also Kannada. And there's a big risk of ending up making a parody of it. Whereas I felt that I wouldn't have that risk and I would do it well. So all of that happened, you know, I translated for the joy of it, but then getting it published was not something I knew how to do. I thought it will fall into place once it's done, and I also thought since it's a Sahitya Academy Award winning novel, it has a lot of literary merit, and if the translation is good, which it is, even if I say so myself, I couldn't have any problem getting it published. But nothing could have been farther from the truth. So I spoke to people. Social media was a good help. I spoke to people I met online and asked them for their advice. And Srinath was one of the people who helped me a lot and told me how to go about it. And so he told me that you should talk to agents. So I spoke to one agent and she seemed quite interested in it. And she took a couple of months to read the manuscript and get back. And it was not eyewash or anything. I mean, she was seriously happy, and she said there's a good possibility that I can represent it. But she asked for money upfront, and I wasn't sure if that was how it was done. And I didn't have the money to pay for it. I quit my job and I was pretty broke. And also I thought, you know, my investment in the book is my intellectual labor and I shouldn't be asked to pay money. And then I didn't know what to do, and I sent it to Anurag. And he rejected it, so it was no hard feelings. I'm sure you have reasons. But I wasn't entirely rejected either. I thought, you know, that there's so many more possibilities and you could go on looking for options. In the meanwhile, Tabish Kher agreed to write a foreword to it, and I really must thank him for this. And, you know, I'm a total stranger who just wrote him a mail, and it was a very earnest mail, and he, despite all his academic and writing commitments, he wrote a very positive foreword. And I thought, okay, with all of that, we can go on looking for more options. But what happened was, the author, you know, he's an opportunity, and he said we shouldn't wait much longer, and let's push it, let's get it done with as soon as possible. So without the luxury of time, it meant that our options were seriously restricted. You know, one of the things I feel is, if, I mean, there may be an amazing writer in one of the Indian languages, but since he's not known beyond his language, there isn't exactly a very good relationship with the English publishing world, so it's difficult to pitch it, right? So, whereas MUP, which published it, they also published Kannada books, so they knew him and they respected him a lot and they were eager to do it and they brought it out in a few months' time. But because of that, it also had a lot of disadvantages, you know. It meant the terms were extremely restricted. It also meant that the editorial process was seriously abridged, and I'm not entirely happy about that. But the book is out now and it's doing well, so it's not an entirely sad story.
But I'm sure as a publisher, on the other hand, Anurag, you received so many manuscripts and obviously everything can't find a home at Speaking Tiger, as is in this case. But at Speaking Tiger, speaking from on behalf of Speaking Tiger, what is the emphasis that you give to translations? You also bring in a lot of translations from elsewhere in the world. You have a list of international translations. So two questions there. One is, how do you make these decisions? I mean, what are the, and I'm also trying to drive on the point that it also depends on what editors like. And it's such a human kind of an interaction when it comes to translation, so there's no real formula to this. And secondly, does giving, I mean, bringing in literature also helps us be known outside? That has been my impression for a long time, that you need to giving and taking. So for the world to know Indian literature, you also need to read the world in a sense.
As far as the first question is concerned, what is the criteria in a sense? Personally, I don't make that distinction between the translation and an original work. Both are original works. I mean, if it is published in some other language, it is an original work that it's just been translated and it has to, and it stands on its own. That's obviously the first criteria, right? That it has to stand on its own, it has to work on its own. Second, I think is a much more subjective decision as an editor, as a publisher. We all know that. Honestly, you know, one can't really make a distinction between a publisher and a reader also. You know, a publisher is always a reader, actually much more of a reader than a publisher. So in that sense, if it strikes a chord with you, I mean, at the end of the day, that is basically the criteria. And of course, then begins the process, as you know, of pitching it internally and talking about it and looking at the potential of it, right? About bringing in literature from elsewhere, it was something that that we'd always wanted to do. It was not something that it was not something that came. It was not a considered marketing decision. I mean, good work was coming our way from elsewhere, especially from South Asia, right? Indonesia, Ekapurniama is is one of the most successful titles in the list, Beauty is the Moon. But again, it struck a chord with us, we thought it could work. And of course then, once you start bringing in work like that, then you classify it in a certain way, and so that became an international fiction list. But you're right, it does help, it does help that we are interested in writing from other places. I think it helps us make a sort of a distinct identity for ourselves. But whether that works the other way around, whether that works in helping us pitch our books elsewhere to these other countries, to these other geographies, to these other readers, I'm not for sure. Because that is again, the outward process is again subjective in the same way that the inward process is. So bringing literature from outside is important, but whether that helps getting the word out for us,
My impression comes from having gone to all these book fairs and looked at how books are traveling. I think there's so little representation of Indian writing in the Indian languages at places where these transactions are taking place. And if that activity were to be increased and improved, I definitely feel that a lot more books would come to attention of editors all around the world. And I'm not just talking about the English world. There's so much. I mean, Kanan, who's sitting here, has succeeded in taking his books directly into other languages that are not English ones. I think Madhuri Bhakan has now gone into Polish. The new edition is in Polish, right?
Czech.
So it also means that that's only happening because he's been going to Frankfurt for the last 10 years or more, regularly. Not all, no, they don't, which is the point. They don't represent the books as much as they should and could. Should, I won't say, but could. So there is, that focus needs to come in if we really want translations to happen. Internationally, I'm saying. Within India, it's a different ballgame, but if one has to look at how to move literature between India and elsewhere, I think wait for people to come and take notice of us is not going to work. And it's really not the way to do it. And since there is a publishing industry, an industry which calls itself an industry, there is that responsibility equally to make sure that our stories travel. So taking that as a point, Vasudhendra, what do you think we should be doing to grab this opportunity of this interest, especially in Kannada now, with like Gacha Gocha having gone to all the way to New York Times? And, what do you think can be done by publishers, say for example in Kannada?
See, it's a very interesting question. I'm speaking about this for quite some time. About it, and also I'm discussing that. You know, like there was some kind of a feeling in the beginning among Kannada authors that we write it in Kannada, that's enough, kind of a thing. You know, like they were least bothered about what it means going outside. Now, with the Gacha Gocha success, people are realizing. You know, so what? And also, what is happening there is it is. I think it's the case with almost all the regional language. The regional language readers are coming down. Day by day, because the English is eating up all the regional language.
Is that really happening?
Very soon all regional languages will be spoken languages only. It will be only English where they will read and write. Because we send kids to the English medium. How can you expect an English medium kid to write in Kannada? He will never write and he will never read. So English is killing all the languages, all the regional languages. So now the question here is, now where do you find your audience or readers? See, though the kid cannot read Kannada, but it likes to read the Kannada story. That's very important. Because kid has seen, it has grown in the Kannada environment, it has grown, his father is Kannada, mother is Kannada, he wants to see what is Kannada story is all about. What is my parents are like? What is my grandparents are there? What is my story, forefather's story? That's important for the kid, not the Harry Potter, though it looks now attractive. But as the kid grows, it would definitely look for the story which is from that area. So from that perspective also, there is a need for us to identify the translation very seriously. Translation is very, very important. But what has happened is, for some reason, the English translation, what was happening before is, person who knew Kannada very well, and he knows to some extent in English, was translating all these things. They did not realize that the destination language hold is more important than the source language. I have translated from Telugu to Kannada. Okay, but my skills on Telugu is not good. I'm not very good at Telugu. But my skills on Kannada is so strong, I can translate it very well. So that is what is expected. You don't have to know very good Kannada to translate a Kannada book to English. Okay, but you should have very good English. But that needs to be trained. It's kind of a thankless job. The translation at the end of the day is quite a thankless job, actually. So you need to train people, you need to groom the people. Government has to take initiative. There are academies also in Karnataka. For the translation purpose itself, in Karnataka we have an academy. But their focus is mainly to bring something to Kannada, but not from Kannada to outside. So that's what was is happening. So it is like a total effort adoption industry, as you said. Nobody will come towards you unless you go and approach and tell. Like in Telugu, there is a say, Adagana Ammaina Pettadu. That means if you don't cry, even your mother won't feed you. Okay, so that kind of a situation is there. So we need to groom people actually. And the recent JCP award is a brilliant one. They gave equal importance for the translation also. And also, Perumal Murugan is here, I would say that. So I loved his short story collection more than the novels and all. The short stories is brilliant actually, the goat thief. When I read, what I felt is, see, the political, this thing, the chaos which happened between the announced that he is going to stop, that scandal made the publisher to publish his book, right? So I felt, was I waiting for all these days for such incidents to happen to read such beautiful text? Is it nice to say, there are so many translators from Tamil to Kannada, nobody did that work. Unless it became at the national level, he became a newspaper. No, that's not the way. We have similar kind of authors, there are many others that needs to be bought in. It's such a brilliant, especially the story Shit, the goat thief, or the well, they are such a nice stories I have read there. And his Kannada book, I'm helping them for translating it into Kannada. The Unachi also is coming in Kannada. So I'm working on that one as well. It will be very soon, it will be out. Amazon is. Westland is publishing it. I'm helping them in getting all the resources for translation, layout, cover page and all that stuff. So we need to take special effort in the translators. The number of translators are very few at the moment and they need to be paid well as well. Many times they will not be paid well. So that needs to be taken care of.
Authors also need to be paid well.
Author has got some kind of a... author has got some other... the name and fame is coming to him. But translator, it is not. Translator is a service, but you need to be paid very well. So that needs to be... That culture has to come. And special interest to be taken in grooming up new translators. And take the works to the outside.
Every time we have this discussion on translations at Publishing Next, and we've had it consistently at every Publishing Next, we talk about translation. We talk about how the translators have to be, you know, we need to create a network of translators, translations have to be, and somehow we are not able to do it because we do need an agency that, you know, takes charge of this. And yeah. I think, again, relying on the government is not going to get us.
Not only just government, but all of them have to come. See, the translation at one metaphor, I always give like, we can't give 100% of the original. Whatever we say, the original is there, that cannot go 100%. It's like, you know, in childhood, we used to see an advertisement for instant coffee, brew. So brew advertisement was like, it gives you the taste almost equivalent to filtered coffee. Filtered coffee is the same. Almost, they don't have courage to say it's as good as the filtered coffee. We can never do. It's the same thing with the translation. That too in case of prose translation. If it is a poetry translation, coffee will become steep.
I've tried to respond to that actually. It's not as useful as that has been. A lot is lost in translation, but a lot can be added in translation. It's about recreating that affect, and you know, when I translate, I also translate poetry, by the way, and when I do that, for me, it's not lexical fidelity that is of importance. It is to make sure that the reader of this work feels what I felt when I read the original one, and to open up new possibilities. So I think a good translator who does it with care can, and you know, I don't know about coffee, and I don't drink instant coffee, but in the case of Vachar Gochar, something new can be added in the translation. If you work properly with the author, you can actually recreate something very beautiful.
No, question here is actually, sorry to take up one thing and say, I respect you, I have a lot of respect, and I myself is a translator. If I say that one, you're insulting myself, I'm not degrading it. But the question is, recreation, is it allowed? You, being a translator, I'm going to recreate something totally different with what I experienced. An author may not like that. I want it to be read as what I have created, not something else.
Moral rights.
Author is also comes in the picture. There are so many issues. It's a challenging task. See, I take around 3 to 4 hours to pen down my own story. But for translation, I take 4 days. the same size of a story. Translation is much more tougher and much more creative than the original writing itself.
Oh,
no doubt
in it. No, we led up to a lot of discussion, but we will come back to this main point, and that's the last thing that I'm going to take up today before we open up to the floor. Shruti, do you think that for to come to the title of our discussion, you know, are we ready for the global, or is, has Indian language literature reached the global table? I mean, I don't know if it's reached, I don't know if it never reached, but as we stand today, we do need to understand a lot of how publishing works in countries like the US, for instance, right? You were saying that there is this, there is such commitment, and there's so much, there's a certain professional way of how they do things, and there is also a system in place which we don't have, and we don't understand it. So even within India, for example, authors find it difficult to approach publishers because we just don't know how to do it. So you have routinely, I mean, every author I meet says this, I don't know how to get started. So every day there are these questions. Something as simple as that should be quite known by now. We don't have enough agents, for instance. So in countries like the US and UK and elsewhere, where publishing industry is more developed in a sense, professionally, they do have a system in place. And is that something we should also be looking to plug into or create in for ourselves? What do you think?
With a view to achieving better sales.
With a view to achieving more exchange.
Discovery of texts.
Yeah, new texts, what is available
in India? I feel Indian editors are quite open actually. And I feel that the Indian publishing industry is not as difficult to access as the American publishing industry is to an American writer, because they, and this very thing, the systems and processes that they have also turn out a lot of young writers and a lot of recent writing very early. It's very nipped in the bud if it's not going to succeed. It's very difficult, you know, in America, you have to do an MFA to have a short story published in a little magazine somewhere in Idaho or whatever. And I don't think we need to aspire to such levels of professionalism. This country would collapse. But, I'm going to say that there are spaces in India which are, as they have said, very challenging but very interesting to get into, which is in within the country translations. And I know that Amazon, Westland are going into that in a big way, but they're doing that because they have to make enough content. There's a different thing there, the contentification of Indian literature, but the tech giants, which Netflix basically is and Amazon basically is, tech giants need content. They're hungry for content, and it's, I think that Indian writers writing in English are not sufficient, or they may not have, there's not enough mature content, because English for us is not a classical language, right? We have only a 60 or 70, or even just an 80 or 100 years tradition in writing it in literary fashion. But there is, all our other languages have been around for a very, very long time, very books there. And so, if Amazon needs Vasudhendra to help with translating Punaji into Kannada, they're doing it because they need to have a Kindle that can handle many languages, because they're trying to push Kindle out into various languages, etc. There's a tech rationale to it, and I think that system is going to be a force multiplier or whatever it is. It's going to be very, interesting times, and there'll be money in publishing in this way.
On that happy note,
that they will be publishing in, I mean, money in publishing for even if it is like this, which is a bit troublesome, but I'll open it up to the floor. We have 5 minutes, so we start. Okay. Questions only, all right? Questions only, please, because we have very little time.
I'm an educator working with government school children in Bangalore. My question to you both, and I told Shravita about this earlier, is why is it that we are unable, this bothers me as an educator, why is it that we are not unable to free ourselves from this grip of high translations in children's literature, very formal Kannada. As an educator, I cannot do read-alongs, and I repeat, I stress, I cannot, because the language is so far away from what the child speaks. So we're losing out a lot with these children. Can we look at this, or re-look at this, and why is it that this happened?
Okay, take that up. Any other questions? Or very short observation points can be allowed. Very, very short. We'll come back to you.
I think what the panels are discussing right now, I think we were coming to the question of transcreation. And I think as one of the panelists said, the destination language is more important, the skill of the writer in that. And also what I want to stress is that, you know, when Rabindranath Tagore translated his own work, it was quite terrible. Fitzgerald translated it. So what do you have to say, like Vegetarian was translated by Deborah Smith, and what the book is out for, she learned Korean just 2 years before. So exactly, so how important is, you know, the transcreation rather than translation?
Thank you. Vasudhendra, do you want to take that question about translation being, you know, very sort of high literary language and that
I think both first should answer that actually. I've not published for kids, but I'm publishing for the different category altogether. I'm not publishing every kid's book. But the language is sadly, the language importance itself has become so low. The kids these days, their vocabulary is very, very little. If I ask, if I was there in my childhood, maybe 5th standard, 6th standard, I used to read Halaganada so easily. That means the written, the prose, the poetry written in 9th century. Kannada 9th century onwards, we have books, right? So 9th century books, I used to read it easily. But now it is not the case with the kids. The level of the Kannada language knowledge has come down among the kids. That needs to be catered. So whatever the vocabulary they have, that needs to be understood, and a special work needs to be done, because writing for kids or children is very, very difficult task, whether it's a translation or writing, this is very tough task, especially with the language, right? So it's a very, very valid point, I find it's important. So we need to look into it, working along with the kids. Ask them, write them to one chapter and read it to them. Are they happy with it? They're able to understand. If not, what is the problem? Then correct it. So that's the way we have to work. We need to bring children also in the translation, in the translation process. So then their inputs will help you to do a better job. But as far as the what kind of books which I have bought from the other countries, it was quite easy. Many of my translators are for me that my book publishing has got one thing as motto, only for youngsters, only those who are writing for the first time, only that I publish. New writing only I publish. I don't publish if it's a celebrity. Okay, so for me, translator also has to be first time translator. I'm very particular about it, so it's to be first time translator. But they take more enthusiasm and the interest, and they have done wonderful work, especially in the software industry. Many translators are from the IT industry,
yes,
actually.
Yes, I know. We are running out of time. So we have to wrap up. So Maitreyi's response would be the last thing, very short one.
Recreation, maybe you can ask.
Yeah,
actually, we can talk about this. No.
Probably
talk about recreation.
I think it was established that the destination language has to be. So to that extent, that discussion had partly taken place.
I also agree that the destination language is to be very strong, and recreation is something that I would push for. sometimes the idiomatic quality of the original language doesn't carry through into the destination language, so in which case it's very important. So I think the translator has to sort of immerse herself in the original, get the feel of it and make sure that it's carried forward. So the example I'd like to give is of the title of the book that I translated. In the Kannada, it said Harla Bantu Harla, which is a shouted out warning that the river is rising. And that was metaphoric for the book, where there is movement in the book. So there is movement from tradition to modernity, and you know, there is leaving something behind and moving on. That was the message that was being given, and it was said that it was done at such a fast pace that, you know, it was like a warning for people to run because the old is being left behind. And so that I could not recreate, I could not transfer it as it was into English. So I came up with the title, A Handful of Sesame, which has nothing to do with the original. But again, what it meant was, you know, there are so many aspects in the book. For instance, this is a very ritualistic household, that is the protagonist household, and they perform the death ceremony where they use sesame seeds. And it's being poured out with water, and that I thought that runs through the novel, and I thought that was a metaphor for leaving something. It was about gaining closure, you know. You leave something behind and you move on, and that I thought represented the novel in the same way as the original title had. So we decided on having this. So that is a kind of recreation. But at the same time, I'd like to add that, you know, when you take that kind of liberty, you should not, as a translator, you should not come with the arrogance of a colonizer. You know, there should be a lot of respect for the original work, and it should happen with the permission of the author, because that's ultimately his or her work.
Thank you so much. Thank you. We need to wrap up. I'd like to thank you all for coming here and giving us your ideas. This has been really good. Thanks, Leo, for organizing this. Thanks to GALF for letting me publish.